Hello everyone, I'm Pradnesh, a pre-final year undergrad student studying engineering physics at IIT Roorkee. And today I'll be giving a presentation on the topic AM, that is the amplitude modulated radio signal transmission, as a part of the coursework for PHN 313 signals and systems course taught by Professor Mayank Goswami from the Department of Physics IIT Roorkee. So through the course of this presentation, we'll be going through an overview of communication systems. Then we'll discuss the process of modulation along with the need and the different types of modulation. We'll then discuss the AM signal transmission used in today's world communication systems. Then we'll discuss the Simulink model that I developed for demonstrating the AM modulator and demodulator behavior, and we'll perform its analysis. Then we'll study the merits and demerits of modulation along with studying the applications of AM based modulation in communication systems. And finally, I'll provide a rough summary of this entire process of modulation along with the applications in the context of communication systems. So if we talk about communication systems, so in general, communication is an exchange of information between two points separated from each other using either a wired or wireless mode of communication. And this information, which is usually expressed in the form of signals transmitting through the communication system, could either be a speech, that is audio, or a video signal. Now, if we consider the human speech signal, then it typically contains frequencies up to 5 kilohertz, whereas the entire audible spectrum varies from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz. Now, in the context of communication systems, which are basically systems which describes the information exchange between two points, this low frequency message signal is often called as the baseband signal. Now, the transmission of these baseband signals through the communication system to a far distance has a lot of challenges. These low frequency signals cannot be transmitted directly because their high wavelength will demand a larger size of the antenna used for transmission if we are using a wireless mode of data communication. And secondly, since the power radiated through this antenna is inversely proportional to the square of the wavelength, the effective power that is radiated by a long wavelength based signal would be small. Thus, for the transmission of these baseband signals, a high frequency periodic signal called a carrier signal is frequently used. So, as we can see here, this particular figure represents a typical baseband signal, which is the signal that is transmitted through the communication system, and this is a high frequency carrier signal. Now, in signals and systems, each signal is associated with a characteristic amplitude, frequency, and a phase. So the carrier signal used in these communication systems is usually just a simple single frequency sinusoid, which varies in time like a sine wave. And by changing either of these parameters of a signal, it is possible to impose the low frequency baseband signal onto a carrier signal, and this process is called as modulation. So as we can see here, this figure represents a typical message signal, a low frequency message signal, which could be a signal representing the human speech, where we often make an assumption that it resembles a sinusoid. This represents a high frequency carrier signal, and these two when combined together produce an amplitude modulated signal. So in this particular case, the amplitude of the initial message signal is varied according to the amplitude of the carrier signal. Now, before we move on to study the different types of modulations, in our case focusing on the amplitude modulation, it is important to understand the need of modulating the signals. So a basic communication system has the following components and structure as depicted in this particular block diagram. The input signal, which in this case is a typical audio signal, is first converted to an electrical signal using a transducer. Then the transmitter, which is the subsystem that takes the information signal and processes it prior to transmission, modulates the information onto a carrier signal, then amplifies the signal, and broadcasts it over the channel. So channel in this case is basically the medium which transports the modulated signal to the receiver. For example, the air medium acts as a wireless channel for broadcasts like radio, which are used for AM and FM signal transmissions. A system can also use wired mode of communication such as the cable TV. Now, this particular component, that is the channel, is also where noise is usually introduced into the system. So these undesired waveforms disturb the transmission of signals and could be generated either due to external factors such as the atmospheric effects or interference, and also due to internal factors such as fluctuations generated at a system level in the communication devices. Now, typically this noise is characterized as Gaussian noise, which assumes a Gaussian distribution with a defined covariance for modeling the noise, or white noise, which is stationary, has zero mean and occupies all frequencies. Often communication systems introduce additive wise Gaussian noise, or AWGN, and this AWGN channel is often included while testing the simulations of the communication systems. Now, this transmitted signal then reaches the receiver side through the channel, which processes it to retrieve the information signal. So the receiver must be able to discriminate the signal from other signals which may be using the same channel. This process is also called tuning. Then amplify the signal for processing and demodulate to retrieve the information. Amplification in this case is often required to ensure a secure and powerful long-range transmission. The receiver also processes the information for reception. For instance, a typical broadcast on a loudspeaker, which is done with the help of another transducer. Now, let's discuss why do we need to perform modulation. So in case of a wireless mode of transmission, antennas are frequently used at the transmitting and the receiving side, and the length of these antenna is proportional to the wavelength of the signal being transmitted. So as an example, if the transmitted signal has a frequency of say 10 kilohertz, then its wavelength can be given by C by frequency, that is 3 into 10 to the power 8 divided by 10 to the power 4, that is 30,000 meters, which makes the antenna length approximately 1/4 of this wavelength, that is 7,500 meters, which is often impractical. Transmitting the same signal at say 10 megahertz would indeed be more useful, and hence the first use of modulation is to reduce the antenna size. Modulation also helps with multiplexing. Each unique signal can be assigned to a different carrier frequency like radio stations and still share the same channel. And thirdly, modulation is also useful for reducing the interference effect. For example, if three signals in almost the same frequency range are transmitted without modulation through a single channel, then there is a risk of interference between them, demanding the use of filter and further signal processing to extract original information. But if each signal is modulated at different carrier frequency and all of them are relatively far from each other, then there won't be much interference and the signals can be easily demodulated at the receiver end. Now, depending on the type of the message signal, the process of modulation can be classified as analog and digital, which can further be classified as continuous wave and pulse modulation in case of analog signals. So AM, or amplitude modulation, is a type of analog modulation where the amplitude of the carrier wave is varied according to the message signal. And these AM are further classified into DSBSC, that is double-sided suppressed carrier modulation. So this DSBSC is where the frequencies produced by modulation are symmetrically spaced above and below the carrier frequency, and the carrier level is reduced to the lowest practical level, ideally being completely suppressed. Then we also have SSB, or single sideband modulation, where only one of the sidebands are suppressed. And third is vestigial sideband modulation, or VSB, where the carrier is suppressed and the power saved is distributed equally to the two sidebands. So algebraically, this process of AM can be represented as follows. So if WC is the carrier frequency, AC suppose denotes the amplitude of the carrier signal, and MT denotes the message signal of frequency F, then the expression for ST, that is the amplitude modulated signal, can be evaluated by a simple superposition of these two waves. And typically, modulation index, which is expressed as the ratio of the maximum information signal to the amplitude of the carrier, is associated with the modulated signal. It can also be interpreted as the fraction of the carrier amplitude that it varies by, and it usually ranges from minus 1 to 1. And later on in the presentation, we'll see two sinusoidally varying signals modulated using Simulink blocks. So there I assumed this modulation index to be 0.5. And this particular modulation property is often used while developing such systems where it helps with time and frequency domain analysis. Now consider the following example to understand the process of modulation and demodulation in communication systems. So the challenge with audio signals is that there is a large shift in the frequencies of the signals to be transmitted and the frequencies of the medium used for transmission. The human vocal signals often have frequencies in the range of about 5 kilohertz. So this is the frequency that we make when we speak, and when we want to transmit them over a communication system, then the AM radio band channels that are used, they often have a frequency range of 540 to 1600 kilohertz. So this is the AM band or the AM radio spectrum, and this is the frequency band where we speak. And we will consider the plots in both time as well as the frequency domain for the analysis. So let's assume a low frequency signal which replicates the human sound. So here's the signal in time domain that we are going to take, and if we take the Fourier transform of this input signal, then this is what it will look like in the frequency domain approximately. So again, if we try to revise Fourier transform quickly, so Fourier transform or FT is basically a mathematical transformation that decomposes functions depending on space or time into functions depending on spatial or temporal frequency. So it represents an analysis of an energy signal as the continuous spectrum of frequencies, which is given by this formula. And to go from frequency to time domain, we use the inverse Fourier transform. More frequently, the optimized implementation of discrete Fourier transforms called FFTs or fast Fourier transforms are used in communication systems since it has better time complexity of the order n log n, and it is extremely useful for latency critical communication systems. Coming back to our example, now to shift this Fourier transform to a higher frequency bandwidth, it is multiplied with a high frequency cosine or sine wave, and this high frequency is close to that of the nearest radio station that will be used for transmitting the signals. So suppose if we select that particular frequency to be F naught, and if we multiply these two, that is this bandwidth signal, message signal, and the cosine wave, that is the carrier signal, then it gives this particular signal which has a different amplitude. So basically, since we are varying the amplitude based on that of the carrier wave, this is called amplitude modulation. The FT of a cosine function is just a scaled and shifted sum of two delta functions, that is functions which have finite magnitude only at a fixed time or frequency and is zero elsewhere. And since multiplication in time domain equals convolution in frequency domain, we can easily plot the corresponding Fourier transform of this amplitude modulated signal. So all this process occurs at the transmitter end of the system, and the original signal is shifted to this new frequency spectrum from the previous one when it was localized at the origin. Now this signal enters the channel where, due to multiplexing, It gets mixed with signals of different but comparable frequencies from other radio stations and noise. And for representation, the other frequencies and the noise are just shown like this. So the receiver should be able to filter out all the noise and get rid of the frequencies from remaining radio stations. And this is often done by taking or basically by multiplying it with this rect function. So rect function is basically square at, in this case, at minus f naught and f naught and zero elsewhere. Multiplication in frequency domain is the same as convolution in the time domain. So in the time domain, we are actually convolving the receiver signal with a function which has the inverse Fourier transform of this frequency domain rect function. And we can evaluate this inverse transform from an operation we performed earlier, like we had this particular function centered around origin, which was shifted by convolving with a cosine function in frequency domain. So using a similar logic, we can assert that this function has an impulse response, which in the frequency domain is the convolution of a square with a cos function. So in the time domain, it is the multiplication of the inverse Fourier transform of the square with the cos function. And the inverse Fourier transform of a square is a sinc function, which is represented like this. So that sinc function multiplied by the cos function will give this final time domain plot. And this component out here is also called as a band pass filter, since it is getting rid of the remaining frequencies. And this plot is actually the impulse response of this band pass filter. And putting the received signal into this band pass filter, having this particular impulse response, will be the same as multiplying with this square function, and the output will only contain our previous original signal. And to recover our input message signal from this, we perform the reverse step. So we multiply it with a cos function in time domain, that is convolve in the frequency domain with a delta function, which will shift that function, this entire function, to be centered on the delta function. So this entire function is shifted on these two deltas centered at minus 2 f naught and 2 f naught, resulting in a half sized copy of the original signal at twice the initial frequency, and a function with the same amplitude will be centered around the origin. And finally, to get rid of these small frequencies located at minus 2 f naught and 2 f naught, we can multiply it with a low pass filter. And in the time domain, the impulse response of a rect is a sinc function, and thus we can recover the original signal. So this process gives an overview of what the amplitude based modulation is and how it is used in the communication systems. But it doesn't occur exactly like this, because these impulse responses of the ideal low pass filters are not causal, because as we can see here, it goes all the way towards infinity in the time domain. So the recovered signal does not exactly resemble the original message signal, as can be seen from the result of our Simulink implementation. So these modulation and demodulation properties can be summarized using block diagram as follows. So the message signal m of t is summed by a constant value, that is, the signal is raised by the constant value with respect to the vertical axis in time domain, resulting in some amplification. Then it is convoluted by the carrier signal, that is ac cos 2 pi fc times t, or an equivalent sine function depending upon the phase under consideration, to create a modulated signal that goes through the channel that introduces noise and frequencies from other stations. So the received signal is then passed through low bandpass filter and multiplied with the original signal again to get the demodulated signal, which is an estimate of the original signal. Now, for this demodulation phase, several techniques are implemented for better filtering, such as the square law and the envelope detector technique, which have been implemented in the Simulink model I developed using the digital signal processing toolbox. So the square law performs the following computation on the input message signal S of t, where the high frequency is removed after filtering. And in order for the low pass filter to detect the information envelope, the frequency of the carrier must be as high as possible. However, the noise from the nature, that is the white noise that we mentioned earlier, it cannot be filtered or removed perfectly in such analog transmissions. So a multiplication with sine gives this function, and then the low pass filter removes the higher frequency components, so we can finally recover the input signal. So following is the block diagram of the amplitude modulator and demodulator that I implemented in Simulink. I used Simulink's digital signal processing system toolbox. So the signal generators, these two signal generators are used to generate two sine waves of amplitude 1 and frequencies 1 kHz and 20 kHz respectively, representing the message and the carrier signal. Taking the modulation index of 0.5, the adder and the multiplier blocks are used to perform amplification and the modulation. So this section out here resembles the square law and the low bandpass filter used to recover the original signal. So here I have used the inbuilt Butterworth filter, which is designed to have a frequency response that is as flat as possible in the pass band. So it is also referred to as a maximally flat magnitude filter, and it resembles the behavior of multiplication with sine and a low pass filter. So by specifying a band edge frequency equal to 2 pi f and using these three spectrum analyzers for visualizing the frequency domain plots, I was able to recover a demodulated signal which had a slightly higher amplitude compared to the original one, and it could further be processed for a better accuracy. So these are the plots that I obtained after running my simulation. So in my case, I used a sinusoidal signal of amplitude 1, and these two represent the signals measured by these two time scopes, and this particular plot represents the modulated signal. And the spectrum analyzer plots are as shown. So this is the plot of the first spectrum analyzer that is out here. So in this case, as we can see, this shows the frequency domain representation of the same time domain plots. So this particular plot is before modulation. This particular plot is, as we can see here, it is the final plot of the demodulated signal. And this represents all the noise that was introduced into the system when it passed through the channel. And finally, this is the output of the time scope. So as we can see, the yellow plot represents the input message signal, and the blue one is the demodulated signal, which is again a sinusoidal signal with a slightly higher amplitude. So as we discussed earlier, the demodulated signal doesn't exactly look like the input message signal, but it has slight variations in the amplitudes. And the following table summarizes the advantages and disadvantages of AM modulation in the context of communication systems. So it is very easy to implement AM, since the circuitry involved to implement these filters is also not so complex and it is comparatively cheap. They are commonly used in broadcasting transmission over short, medium and long wavebands. And since AM is easy to demodulate, radio receivers for amplitude modulation are therefore easier and cheaper to manufacture. So these AM based modulation techniques are often used in airband radios for many airborne applications such as ground to air radio communications or two-way radio links for ground staff personnel. However, the interference is quite significant. Also, the bandwidth of the channel used for transmission is quite large, often equivalent to the highest audio frequency. So finally, I'll summarize whatever I discussed so far. So AM is one of the types of modulation where the carrier wave frequency is kept constant, whereas the amplitude is varied depending on the amplitude of the modulating signal, and the output is a modulated signal which has amplitude different from the input message signal. Each type of amplitude has its own merits and demerits, thus it should be properly evaluated first to find the most suitable one tailored for a particular communication system. And finally, I have included the references. So I have included the Simulink model that I designed. Then I have also referenced the digital signal DSP system toolbox, and these two links, the envelope detection for demodulation and DSBSC, was used to cover the theoretical aspects of the Butterworth filter that I implemented for demodulation. So thank you, and this was it from my side.